Well, thank you so much. I'm very honored to have been invited. And Derek, you made such a wonderful program, very exciting. And I think it's probably the exceptional time we could have all our colleagues together like that. So thanks a lot. Well, I will give you my own view on how the field of diffusion MRI evolved over the last 30 years, and give you some insight also about what I'm trying to do now. And as Derek calls me very often the grandfather, I have to pay my tribute to the great, great grandfathers, Brown, because he basically discovered the Brownian motion. I know that diffusion is not exactly Brownian motion in biological tissues, but still, this is where it started. And then I like to mention Vantoff. I know, of course, there are the thick laws, but I think that he was also quite a big pioneer in diffusion. But of course, the most important cornerstone, I think, of all of what we do is Einstein, with his PhD thesis back in 1905, where he explained the Brownian motion in terms, he explained diffusion in terms of the Brownian motion, and this is the equation we are all using, more or less, when we do diffusion MRI. But the point I'd like to make is that the idea of Einstein was not really to measure diffusion or whatsoever. He was trying to prove the existence of atoms and molecules, because at that time, almost half of the physicists didn't agree that atoms and molecules could exist. So the idea of Einstein was to develop the theory of the kinetic heat theory to show that the heat was related to the movement of molecules. And this is how I lose my voice. Okay. It could be a proof that water molecules or any molecule existed. In fact, Jean Perrin used Einstein's theory to prove the existence of water molecules and even estimate its size in 1908. So the message here is that from the mind of Einstein, it was clear that diffusion was a way to bridge the microscopic and the microscopic worlds, which we are trying to do with diffusion MRI. So many, many, many years later, diffusion MRI was possible because MRI was invented. So this is because Derek asked me to show some old slides. So this is me in 1984. I was working also in the CEA at that time. I was a student, a medical student and physics student. And with this magnet, we cannot make imaging. So I was very lucky. In fact, I had a lot of luck in my career to have an access to the very first MRI scanner in France called from the company CGR. And my question was, well, we have nice images. They are the original images from that time. Could we get some information, because usually MDs, that's what they want, about the structure of the tissue? Could I make a virtual biopsy of the tissue, especially the brain? And my idea was that if we consider Brownian motion of water in tissues, water molecules could be seen as spikes to tell us some information about what they see. So the idea was to see how the hindrance of water diffusion by tissue elements would provide us information about the microstructure. So I was very lucky because the CGR people invited me to join them, and the radiologist at that time, all of my mentors, also welcomed this idea, and I could do my work. And another piece of luck is that if you take Einstein's equation for diffusion, and at the brain temperature, with the diffusion times we use, the displacement of the water molecules is a few micrometers. So it's the right range to probe the tissue for medical applications. So that's how it started. And again, the idea was to have some information in the microscopic world. Also, we had a microscopic image resolution. So after the great-great grandfathers, now we have the great grandfathers. and this is how a diffusion MRI arrived in the 1984-85. So at that time, I think, if I recall well, there were several attempts Mike can, I'm sure we talk about it, with WISBI, they had devised a method. I think they were using the selection gradient pulse, and they had to calibrate with a known diffusion coefficient, but he will talk about it. Taylor had a spin echo sequence, and Meerbolt, I remember very well, because that was my very first presentation at the, not ISMRM, but SMRM at that time. In 1985, it was at the Barbican, and now I put in my slides in the speaker-ready room on diffusion, and next to me was one guy putting slides also on diffusion. Oh, and it was Meerbolt. So Meerbolt had an abstract on using stimulated echoes, and I was using gradient echoes, spin echoes, I'm sorry. And so this was published, in fact, in this 1985 paper in French, in the French Compte Rendu of Académie des Sciences. But I think this is where I introduced many of the terms that we are using today. Of course, the idea is that I wanted to implement John's and Ed's sequence into MRI. It looks trivial, but I can tell you it was not at that time. The problem is that because there are many gradients used for imaging, we could not use John's and Ed's equation straight away. We had to modify it. We had to recalculate everything to take into account all these gradients. So this was patented. We had several patents. And the way I mentioned that is that I did this work with CGR. The patent belonged to CGR, but GE bought CGR in 1987, which means that all of this work suddenly went to GE. And I'll tell you later why it is important. So because of this, I introduced, it was complicated, and if we wanted to have diffusion MRI successful in the clinical world, that was with equations like that, they would not like it. So this is how I introduced the B factor to simplify all of this, because of course it would depend on each sequence. And I use B is for my name, I have to say. And this is the story behind the B factor, which became later a B matrix, as I will show, and which is now also a B fat tensor. So the B factor became fat. So. And also at that time, I had studied very in deep, great deepness, the work of John and Ed about restricted diffusion, sorry for the French, but that's my own notebook from the time, anisotropy and so on. But there was a big problem too, is that the gradient pulses we used were very wide in terms of duration. So we could not use those equations. So the idea came that, let's forget that for a moment, and assume that we will use a free diffusion framework. So that was the equation, so the B factor instead of complicated gradient terms, and the apparent diffusion coefficient to hide our misery that what we will measure is not real diffusion. It's not only hindered diffusion. I think, John, you had also used apparent diffusion at some point in your papers, DA, but that was different. The idea was all the features which could be involved in the diffusion measurements, and I'll show you in the next slide, the IVIM effect. So the idea was very simple. The gradients were not symmetric. We could not do that. Just to have this simple equation to obtain diffusion maps. And very at the same time, we showed that it was possible to get diffusion images in the human brain. So that was published in Radiology in 86. This paper has been cited 2,000 or 3,000 times. I don't know exactly, but it has been highly cited. And the images we got at that time, I was so excited. It was the first time we got images of diffusion in the human brain. We could see things that you could not see with T2 or T1 and so on. And again, we used ADC maps. And there were some features, for instance, like a CSF flow, which is not diffusion. That's why we call it also the ADC, because we were sensitive to other things than diffusion. Now, but that's just because I look at the images when I make my talks, it might be that what was there was anisotropy, but we completely missed it at that time. And in fact, the one who I think made diffusion MRI in the clinical world was Mike, because he was the first to show this was good, of course, but that in acute stroke, there was no other way to look at acute stroke. So I think that was really another cornerstone which made diffusion MRI into the clinical world. But I have to say that it was not yet ready. There were many problems. artifacts, especially. So I worked on all the eddy current effects. You see all this, this annulus here is just because of misregistration, because of eddy currents. So there were many problems. Also, the B value we could get at that time were about 100, 200 at best on good days with the wind in the back. And also, so because of that, a spin echo sequence, we had tons of motion artifacts. So what made really a big difference is when I moved to NIH to learn how science works, when I met Bob Turner. He's not here, but he's coming tomorrow.
I have a video presentation.
Ah, video, okay. So Bob Turner, we worked together. He built this gradient coil, and with the help of GE, because GE had the patent for us on diffusion MRI from a few years earlier, so we could, with the help, to build the first prototype of EPI linked to diffusion and IVIM. And I think this is how we could get beautiful images, finally, of diffusion in the brain. In one, less than 1 minute, you could get 16 different B values, no motion artifacts, and the B value increased from 100 to 1,000. So that made really a big change. Okay, so we are building this this picture, as you will see. And I think this is how a clinical diffusion weighted imaging started, with stroke and then neurological disorders and application in the body oncology. At the same time, I had shown, in fact, back in this article here, you can see application to diffusion and perfusion, that if we look at the very low B values, there was some curvature in the plot here of the log of S versus B, which could not be explained by diffusion. And I introduced this IVIM effect, showing that, in fact, it's a random motion of blood in the capillaries, which was responsible for a pseudo-diffusion effect, which I call IVIM. And back then, in 1986-88, my idea was to see how IVIM, which is sensitive to perfusion, could be used to produce fMRI. There was no fMRI at the time. So these were images I obtained in the daughter of my physics mentor. So I asked her to come into the magnet. At that time, it was easy to do experiments like that. In fact, there was something. So with the visual stimulation, we could see something. But it was not so strong. And that was the time when I decided to move to NIH, who I dropped. And anyway, at that time came fMRI with gadolinium, which didn't survive the development of ball fMRI. But just to be comprehensive, Alan Song in 2002 showed beautifully that you can use IVIM to obtain activation maps of the brain. Of course, bald is much easier. So for many years, people didn't consider IVIM as very useful, but and especially it was the fact that diffusion MRI could be used for perfusion was a little bit confusing. So I remember at NIH, some of our colleagues had T-shirts, like diffusion, perfusion, confusion. James Picard and all these people. So, okay, but anyway, nowadays you know that you can do perfusion imaging with IVIM. It's developing a lot. These are perfusion maps obtained in the breast. You can even do angiography with IVIM. And at the same time, perfusion MRI has developed a lot with techniques such as contrast agents or ASL. But today, contrast agents, people have concern about using them because, as you know, deposits have been observed in the brain tissue. And when you have several exposure to gadolinium chelates. So I think IVIM has probably a great potential. Okay, we go back now to diffusion. And to Mike Mosley, who made, about the same time, another big discovery that diffusion in, you can correct me if I'm wrong later, that diffusion in white matter was anisotropic. So this was also a completely new avenue that started then. And I was at NIH at the time, and with Philip Dweck, we said, well, if diffusion is not the same according to the direction of the fibers, it's faster along the fibers, we can reverse this ID and obtain images where we show, depending on the highest diffusivity direction, the orientation of the fibers. So that was the very first, I think, coloring of white matter. So white matter became colorful. And we at that time, we used like a vector approach, measuring diffusion in two perpendicular directions or three perpendicular directions. So the results were really amazing, that we could see non-invasively the orientation of the fiber tracks just by doing diffusion. So this is a time where I met Peter Basser, and we at a poster at a fair, science fair at NIH, and we discussed these results. And Peter said, "Sure, but if we could use a tensor, it would be much more. You could get much more interesting information." And for some time, you will tell your story, of course. We worked together because also diffusion is known as a tensor. At that time, it was not known how we can measure a tensor with NMR or MRI. It had not been done before. So we had to develop all the framework, and Peter will talk about it. It was not so easy to get it accepted. Again, the paper was submitted in 92, but published only in 94. And also with our postdoc, Jess Mattiello, what now to update the B vector as a B matrix, taking into account all the cross terms between all the pulses between different directions. So it became really more complicated, but it worked very well. And the ADC was basically split in three different concepts. The mean ADC, which was equivalent to classical ADC, from the trace of the tensor, some anisotropy indices, and also the direction of the fibers. So I think, because I left NIH in 94, Peter continued, and especially with Carlo Pierpaoli, to this work. And to me, this is really a remarkable paper by Klinberg, which I think was working with Mike Mosley at that time, where he showed for the first time that the degree of anisotropy in white matter in specific regions of the brain linked to language reading, that you can appreciate like a functional information how dyslexic people could read well or not. Maybe Mike will talk about it, so I'll stop here. But to me, that was really something outstanding that with this measurement, we could do that. So that's a story at that time. So we are 92, 94. And then the next step was tractography. And the idea was now to use artificial vision paradigms or algorithms to connect points together in space, not only to show ellipsoids, but to reconstruct tracks. And I think there were three groups at that time who published about the same different algorithm, but the same idea. So Susumu Mori at Hopkins, Tom Conturo, and Cyril Poupon at CA. So I think that we know now that we can get gorgeous images. But if you think back, you know, these images, which are really, I mean, no way you could predict that you would see such beautiful images, they are obtained from measuring the Brownian motion in the brain. So I think it's really fantastic. Even myself, when I look at these images, I'm always amazed to see that we can get such gorgeous information, which is not just coloring, you know, it's so real information, just because of the movement of water molecules in fibers. I have to speed up a little bit. I'm going fast already, but so this is a picture now. And something which happened also, which changed our life, was tremendous progress in the gradient hardware. And of course, it is epitomized by the connector gradient from Siemens to get to high B values, and then to look at non-Gaussian diffusion. So basically, to go beyond the ADC. So it's used for the human brain connectome. But now it has entered also the field of clinical imaging. So I give some, don't look at the details. I give you some slides to show you the picture, but don't, no need to go to the details. So we know that at high B values, we don't get a straight line as we would get for free diffusion. We have a curvature because water molecules interact with obstacles, and diffusion is not Gaussian. So basically, I would say there are three kinds of avenues that people have used. The first kind is just to describe the curvature. And I give you two examples. One is to consider that diffusion is bi-exponential. which means that there are two tissues in the measurement volume in slow exchange. Well, good. It seems that it works. The problem is that we could not identify the compartments. It's naively, we would say, well, it corresponds to the intra and the extracellular compartments. We could have also the Karger equation to take account of exchange effects. But if you look closely, it doesn't work very well. Second big model, we talked, this was explained this morning, is the cumulant expansion and using the kurtosis model to describe the deviation from a Gaussian behavior. So this works well if you don't want to go to high B values. If you go beyond 2,500, this model fails and it cannot be used. But anyway, I think it's getting a lot of attention in the clinical world, so why not? But all these models just describe the curvature. They don't give you an explanation about the tissue. So group of models is to consider now what I call analytical models. So to have some information about parameters of tissues, such as the shape, the size, and exchange, and so on. The problem is that we have to reverse the diffusion signal to get those parameters. And I think that this is ill-posed. There are too many parameters, and the signal is not rich enough to give us all this information, which means we have to make very strong hypotheses in order to get the information we want. So basically, we need to know a little bit what we will find to get the results. So that's, I think, a problem with those models. Also, they are also very successful. I just mentioned two very quickly. Don't look at the details. The Excalibur and Charm model to estimate the white matter fiber axon diameter. So it's very important because we know that how the brain works is that the information is flowing to the brain according to the size of the myelin. So it is a very important piece of information. So it works using a very specific model, but you have to put some strong hypothesis, and especially in patients, those hypotheses might not hold anymore. The second model, it's a NODI model, which is also a grid. We use it a lot. But again, you have to make hypotheses to simplify what we see. So so you see description of the MRI signal as empirically works well, but we don't get really information on the tissue. And predictive models based on geometric features work well, but you have to make strong hypotheses. So another avenue which are now trying to pursue is to consider that maybe we should be simple. So the ADC was extremely successful. It's used clinically every day. It's very simple, just two B values. But it doesn't pick up the information which is seen at high B values. So a very naive view is to consider that, well, you just have to shift the ADC. Instead of 0, 1,000, you go, for instance, to 200, 1,500. That's a very, very simple idea. But it works incredibly well, because then you capture more of the non-Gaussian diffusion, so more of the interaction of the water molecule with membranes. And especially for cancer, this is quite important. So you can identify B values, which are optimized to give you the highest sensitivity to the disease. The second line of model-free analysis that you can do with diffusion MRI is just to forget any model. Just to say, well, this is a typical signature I have for malignant tissue or any kind of tissue, let's say malignant, and this is a typical signal with noise I will have with benign tissue. Now I have a patient, and in one voxel, this is a signal I get. So just by looking at the signal, you should say, well, it looks it is a malignant tissue, just by looking at the signal profile. No calculation, no model, nothing. So this voxel, oops, I can lose my voice. No way, okay. And it works really well. Again, you can also, you don't need to take all the B values, just take the ones which are the most influential in terms of the differentiation of the signals. So it's very short in terms of acquisition time and very straightforward in terms of processing. just calculate distances, and you can get a scale, which we call the S-index, which tells you what is the tissue you have underneath. And just to give you an example, this is a rat brain glioma that we have implemented. And this is a 3D representation of the S-index. This is histology. In fact, there is a very strong agreement between the part of the tumor which is extremely active, the part which is necrotic, and so on. So I think it's another promising avenue to look at the diffusion signal for tissue recognition, which has to be evaluated, of course. Another avenue that we really recently touched upon is virtual elastography. The idea is also very simple. Diffusion is about tissue microstructure, and elasticity also about tissue microstructure. So elasticity is obtained, for instance, to measure the shear modulus from vibration of tissues using MR elastography. But if we can prove that there is a relationship between, for instance, the SADC or the S-index and the shear modulus, then we don't need vibration. We can obtain images of shear modulus without vibration. So this is what we've done with my colleague from Japan, from Yamanashi University, in the liver. So these are the shear modulus obtained from MR elastography, real one, and this is from virtual measurements based on the SADC. So and the correlation is extremely, extremely good, and this is important because this is how you can get staging for fibrosis in the cirrhotic patients. And you can get, for instance, these are standard MRE obtained using vibration, and these are virtual elastograms obtained without vibration. So the results are really amazing, and you can do even more if you consider that for elastography, there are waves propagating to the tissues. They will induce, in the presence of the field gradients, phase shifts. But in each voxel, there is a distribution of phase shifts. So if you have a tissue with a high modulus, then the dispersion is high. Is low, I'm sorry. While in the background tissue, where you have a low elasticity, and then you have a very high dispersion. So you get an IVIM effect, in fact. And what we've shown is that you can obtain images, for instance, of a liver cancer tumor at virtual frequencies. So again, there is no vibration. But because you know the elasticity of the tissue from diffusion, you can simulate what would be the contrast obtained with actual vibration. I think it is quite promising, too. OK, so I'm going now to the final part. So this is virtual elastography. And another field which I'm pushing a lot, as some of you might know, is diffusion fMRI. So as I mentioned earlier, BOLD works very well for fMRI, we know. But we know also there are limitations. For instance, the time lag, and also the fact that different areas of the brain share some vasculature and cannot be separated with BOLD. This was shown in a paper last August, I think, where people measured in the visual cortex the response to the orientation of the stimuli and could prove that the vascular effects was not related at all to what they could observe with other markers. I don't want to go to the detail there. So talking with my friend Ozawa, I mean, we have talked for many, many years. We know each other very well. I suggested that if water diffusion is sensitive to microstructure of tissues, we should have a way to look at tissue activation, neuronal activation, just by diffusion. So this is what we've published back in 2006. And we got very beautiful images of activation of the visual cortex. And what we see is that when the visual cortex is activated, the diffusion goes down. And not only that, but if you look at the time course, so this is the visual stimulus, 10 seconds. This is the BOLD response. And what we see is that the diffusion response is much faster and time-locked with the activation. So because of that, we suggested that what we see with diffusion has nothing to do with BOLD, and it's something different related to the tissue. So the diffusion will be more related to neuronal activation, so what we believe is neuronal swelling, while the ball, of course, is related to the vascular effects. So this is what we have called the neuromechanical coupling hypothesis. So it took more than 10 years for diffusion MRI to be accepted, almost 20 years for IVIM to be accepted. But for diffusion fMRI, it's taking also a while. And it's hard to prove that what we see is not vascular. So we've done experiments, I go quickly also here, where we block the ball response with natural prechate. It's known to block the diffusion, the ball response. And we see that, for instance, in this model where we stimulate the right somatosensory cortex, that the activation that we see with diffusion remains intact, even under natural pressure, while it disappears with ball. I'll skip this one for interest of time. To go to this experiment, which I think is quite interesting. So this is a rat which is under anesthesia. And if you go with an electrode in a specific location of the brain, like in the thalamus, in the central median nucleus, you can wake up the animal. Also, it is under anesthesia. Of course, depending on the amount of anesthesia, the threshold, electrical threshold to wake up the animal, so you've seen the animal has wake up just by electric stimulation. So now what we've done is to inject locally a drug such as furosemide, which is blocking cell swelling. So there is no more cell swelling. And what we see at that time is that not only the diffusion coefficient locally increases, but the threshold to get this awake response is increasing. So basically, by blocking cell swelling, you block the neuronal activation locally, and you increase the ADC. Instead, if you inject, I will not say water, but hypotonic CSF, then you enhance the cell swelling, then you get the ADC to decrease. And at the same time, you see that you facilitate the awake response. So basically, it becomes much easier to obtain a response. So this points out, as this is a summary, that the ADC, the measurement of water in the tissue, reflects some neuronal activation in the background. And again, that to us, that's indication that when we measure diffusion for fMRI, we are sensitive to cell swelling. What is also quite remarkable, if we look at the distance effect, like in the somatotensory cortex or the cingulate cortex, where we don't do anything, we just measure the diffusion coefficient. If you manipulate cell swelling in the CM, you induce changes in the diffusion coefficient in the cingulate cortex and in the somatotensory cortex. So basically, these effects are really linked to the way the neurons works. So basically what we see here is the functional connectivity linking different regions of the brain through diffusion, not through ball. So I have to finish. So the summary here I'd like to point out is that it's well known in the neuroscience, in the neurobiology, that neuronal swelling is involved in neuronal activation, and probably this swelling occurs not at the body of the neurons, but along the spines. You know that the dendrites are full of spines, and in fact, if it works, doesn't work. Dynamically, you see all of this is dancing all the time, so it's a dynamic effect. So the model we propose is that depending on the degree of activation, so between activation, resting, anesthesia, the amount of swelling will vary, and at the same time, the ADC will change. So that's a new paradigm, of course, which has to be proven in more details, but that's, I think, another potential of diffusion MRI. I keep this slide because I don't have the time, but just to point out that we've done the experiments in the single neurons using the aplasia model at 17 Tesla. And what we see is that when we stimulate those neurons, we get activation and swelling. And inside the neurons, there is increased diffusion, which we expect because there is a dilution effect. But on the ganglia level, if you take a region of interest taking all these neurons, we get a decreased diffusion. And it cannot be explained by shrinking of the extracellular space in terms of numbers. So the only difference is that between the intracellular compartment and the whole area are membranes. We've done the experiment also with dopamine, where we get real physiological activation, and we have the same results. So one model I think that we should not overlook, because we usually consider restricted diffusion in terms of compartments, geometry, and so on, is that there might be some water molecules bound to cell membranes, which are responsible for a decrease of the water diffusion coefficient in general. So if you have cell swelling, you increase this pool of slow diffusing water. If you decrease the swelling, you increase the ADC just by decreasing the amount of slow diffusing water. So the controversy here is how far does this layer extends. Is it very thin? In this case, it will have no impact. Or is it somewhat large, and then it will have an impact? So this has to be looked in the future. OK, so this is the full picture now. I will not talk today, but we should not forget that there is also spectroscopy, which is interesting. But I'd like to conclude with this to show that diffusion MRI has been extremely successful over the last 30 years. With many, many fields, but we have to be patient. It takes many years for fields to develop. And so this is diffusion back from 1984, diffusion imaging, from 84, 85 to now, with many applications, successful applications. And I looked in preparing this talk in Google Scholar, diffusion MRI has more than 1 million entries. And I think that it's because of most of you. I mean that everybody has contributed so well to this field that I think this is very nice. So I'm very, very pleased that this field and what you have done also, Derek, to have this wonderful workshop. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for taking us so clearly through diffusion from conception to maturity. So an opportunity to ask questions.
Yeah, so the idea is that you build a database, a library of signals. So from tissues that you know in advance are supposed to be this type or this type. And then when you have when you do an experiment, you compare the signal, so calculate the distance between the signal from the tissue you want to investigate and the library. So you calculate the distance with all the types, and just the one which is the closest is probably the tissue nature. So that's it. And you don't need to do that for many B values. What we've shown there is that only a few are key to make this classification.
But it could be done also by means of fits or some parameters. You can have
for this. Sure, but fitting means that I completely agree, but to do the fitting, you need a model. You have to fit with the model. Here we don't want any model. Okay? Second, so big difference. Second, to fit, you need many points. You need to acquire many, many time points or many B values. And it's very sensitive to noise. So this is much more robust. And I think this is a trend now that we see that instead of doing a fancy fitting, we just have a library of signals and we compare. So it's not fingerprint, but because there is no sparse sampling and so on, but it's a little bit the ID.
Final bit where you're saying that water is slowed down near membrane, right?
That's a model.
Right? So why not just a minimalistic sort of Occam razor explanation that, you know, diffusion is just slowed down near membrane just because of interaction with geometry?
We calculated.
The need of having this, kind of magic layer of
No, no, we know that. So in fact, if you look at the fact that water molecules will have to bounce, if you forget membrane, it's an obstacle, because water diffusion cannot go on the other side, they have to go back. So that means that if you measure the diffusion coefficient, the profile, you can see that there is a decrease in diffusion next to the obstacles. And I think, John Tanner, you showed that in one of your papers, if I remember well. Maybe it was somebody different, but you have this decrease of diffusion.
The width of this layer is just the diffusion
layer. Right, right, but so it's not compatible with what we measure, so I think it's different.
So I think that's actually the way to explain the Diana's experiment.
Yeah, yeah. No, I'm perfectly aware of that, but I don't think that's what we see.
Okay.
Time for a very quick one.
So I had a quick question about in this flowing water, because it could be an idea, but on the other hand, if the water slows down near the boundaries of cell membranes, its deep relaxation is very, very short, and therefore those are basically the spins that we don't see.
Right.
Right? Or
well, I think I thought you were asking something different, but you are right, but except that we are not looking at the same time frame. So for T2...
Okay, so you are assuming that still this water is exchanging with the others.
Right, right. Okay. So we have done magnetic transfer experiments to see if there is something. So far, we have not conclusive results, but we are trying it with the aplasia model because we can have a better resolution. So there is somebody in our team looking at MTC effects for water to see if we can see the exchange of water.
Is aplasia model a fair model? Because aplasia is such a huge cell that you basically don't have any exchanges. You don't actually...
Yeah, but we see the decreased ADC also. So if it is linked to the membranes, it should be the same physical phenomena.
We can continue later. I'm sure this discussion will come. Let's say thank you very much again.